This is my Bible. It is the Word of God, and it is the will of God for my life. I am who the Word says I am. I'm the righteousness of God in Christ. I'm where the Word says I am, seated right now in the heavenly realms, in Christ Jesus, in the place of authority, dominion, and power. I have what the Word says I have. All the blessings of Abraham are mine, and I can do what the Word says I can do. I can do all things through Christ who gives me the strength. Today my mind is alert. My spirit is receptive. As I'm taught the Word of God, my life is changed for the better, and I will never be the same again. Can you say amen? Before you're seated, let me pray. Father in heaven, I thank you for the wonderful life that you have blessed me with. I thank you, Father God, that from those days in Highland Park, Michigan, on East Grand Avenue, that your hand was upon me. I thank you, Lord God, that you directed my mother to find and to take me to Bethesda Missionary Temple. I give you the credit, the glory, and the honor for everything that has happened in my life, all that I've seen, all that I've been able to do and accomplish. But I'm mindful today, Father God, of the children all over this world and in the natural. It doesn't look like there's any way they could have a wonderful life. There are children in the world today and the father's not there. There are children in the world today, and even if mom and dad are there, that child will never be loved, never be cared for. I pray for the children, Lord God, in Nigeria and other places that are being kidnapped by Muslims and pressed into sex slavery. I pray, Lord God, for all the young people in Europe that are being beguiled by drugs and pressed into sex slavery. I pray, Lord God, we have entire sections and states of this country where heroin addiction has just run rampant and destroyed lives. And now, Father God, tens of thousands of youngsters in America are being put into foster care because mom and dad are both on heroin. I pray, Lord God, for the children. I pray for those, Lord God, in Africa and other places who are hungry today. I pray, Lord God, for the children. And I pray in Jesus' name that you would send workers across their path to tell them the good news, that even though mom and dad might have let them down and even though they may be hungry, here is some food. Glory to God. And Jesus has lived and come and given his life that they might be saved and set free. And our great Father is so wonderful. He can put them on a trajectory. They will intercept where they would have been if they had had a wonderful life all along. I pray for them, Father God, in the name, and even in our own inner cities. My God, my God, my God, the greatest, richest nation in the world. How many millions in our own inner cities will never even know that they're in America? They'll never even know of freedom and prosperity and liberty because of where they have found themselves, and that is through no fault of their own. It is the failure of their mom and their dad to not get out of those situations. My Father, my Father, my Father, in the name of Jesus, I thank you. I thank you for what you have done in my life, and I see by the Word that you want every human being to have a wonderful life here and now, and then come to know your beloved Son that we might spend eternity with you. But I pray for the children especially, Lord God, because many of them are being robbed. They're being robbed. Satan is a thief and a liar. Father, make us rich, I pray, without apology in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, that we might send more and more and more into missions and into feeding the hungry around the world. Father God, make us a blessing. Father, more than we can ask or imagine, and help us to be a part of a great army in these last days to win children to a saving knowledge of the Lord Jesus Christ. Why should they suffer because of their parents? Why should they do without because of the country they've been born into? That was not their choice. I pray for them in Jesus' name. And I pray, Lord God, that through this message, you would open eyes and grant unto your children revelation of your intention toward us, that we might not ever again allow ourselves to be lied to by the devil. For it is not you, our wonderful Father, who denies us any good thing. It is Satan. He is a thief. He is a robber. He is a devourer. He is our enemy. And because he knows his time is short, he has gone out into the earth with great wrath. But you have told us to be sober and to be vigilant. And you have told us to resist him. And you would not have told us to resist him if he could not be resisted. You have told us to not give him place. And you would not have told us to not give him place if it was not our decision and our authority. So in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, as we begin this message, by the word of my testimony and by the blood of the Lamb, I break the power of Satan over everyone in this room. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth and by the blood of the Lamb, I break the power of Satan over this church. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth and by the blood of the Lamb, I break the power of Satan over any who will hear this message or see it online. I declare liberty and freedom and deliverance to all who are here today. And it's in the name of the Holy Child Jesus that we pray. And everyone in agreement said amen. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Now this morning in Luke 13, we come to a passage that is an example of what I've been hearing in prayer and what E.W. Kenyon wrote about in The Hidden Man. The title this morning is Freedom from Sickness. We're still in the series, What Did Jesus Really Say? Luke 13, 10. On a Sabbath, Jesus was teaching in one of the synagogues, and a woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Now, I want you to notice the language of the Word of God. And frankly, I'm embarrassed that Jesus is still being misrepresented. I mean, how can people learn to read and the Bible be so plain and our wonderful Savior be so misrepresented, and our wonderful Father be so misrepresented? A woman was there who had been crippled by a spirit for 18 years. Now, she was crippled by a spirit. She was not crippled by God. She was not crippled by the will of God. She was crippled by a spirit for 18 years. She was bent over and could not straighten up at all. When Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. Indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue ruler said to the people, "There are 6 days for work. So come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath." The Lord answered him, "You hypocrites, doesn't each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her?" You see it? Whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, not whom God has kept bound for 18 long years, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years. When he said this, all his opponents were humiliated, but the people were delighted with all the wonderful things he was doing. So what did Jesus do? Well, Jesus declared to her freedom. Verse 12, when Jesus saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Now, we need to explain this because there is a method of operation that we have gotten away from. Hold your place in Luke 13 and look at Luke 4. Luke 4, verses 18 and 19, Jesus, quoting out of Isaiah, said, "The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor." There have been some in the faith movement who have gotten off into universalism, and I can see why, although it is error, because A lot of times we have a wrong perspective of what is occurring when people get saved or healed or set free or delivered. When Jesus was on Calvary's cross, before he gave up the Spirit, he said, "It is finished." After he ascended on high, he sat down at the right hand of God. Sitting down is a sign of your work being done. So there is a sense in which everybody is saved. There's a sense in which everybody is healed. Not experientially, but legally. You understand the difference? In other words, whosoever shall call upon the name of the Lord shall be saved. They've got to call. But that does not negate the fact that Jesus has already paid the price for their healing, for their salvation, for their deliverance. And you see how ministers in human mercy can get swept up in this and go too far and say, well, everybody's saved. Well, everybody is saved legally. I mean, if you get arrested or let's say they knock on your front door, you know, and they want to come in and look around. You can say, come on in, or you can say, you got a warrant. You say, come on in, they're coming. So you have to know what is yours. And not just that, this salvation is a gift. He's not shoving it down anybody's throat. You want to go to hell? You know, he'll let you. Amen. So our job is not to run around trying to get people saved or healed or delivered, whatever. We are proclaimers. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news. See, it's good news. It's not bad news. Why do people not get results? Well, they're going around preaching bad news, telling people, you know, you're going to hell. They already know they're going to hell. That's why they're doing marijuana. They already know they're going to hell. That's why they're in therapy. You don't have to tell somebody you're messed up. They know they're messed up. No, it's not bad news. It's good news. The price is paid. Hallelujah. Your sins were nailed to a tree. Hallelujah. He went to hell for you. Hallelujah. So you wouldn't have to go. And all of this comes out of Isaiah. And with his stripes, we have been healed. Past tense. With his stripes, we have been. So the work's done. The healing's been paid for. Hallelujah. So we don't have to. See, I think we create work in the ministry and we're trying to do work that's already been done and we're trying to do work that we can't do. I can't save anybody. I can't deliver anybody. I can't heal anybody. But I can sure enough declare what Jesus has already done. And if you'll hear and believe, faith cometh by hearing and hearing by the word of God, then it becomes yours. Amen. That's all it is. All salvation is, all healing is, all deliverance is hearing the good news and making it mine. Amen. Well, Pastor, there has to be more to it than that. Well, yeah, that's what the passage is about. Because if it were just Jesus and us, well, we just skate. Amen. But there's an enemy out there. The Spirit of the Lord is on me because he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim freedom for the prisoners and recovery of sight for the blind, to release the oppressed, to proclaim the year of the Lord's favor. Now let's go back to Luke 13 and look at verse 12. When he saw her, he called her forward and said to her, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." Did he not just proclaim her liberty? That's all he did. He didn't get out the little MD bag and start going to work on her. No, he proclaimed, "Woman, you are set free from your infirmity." And then he laid hands on her, verse 13, then he put his hands on her, and immediately she straightened up and praised God. So we ask the question, what did Jesus do? Now, what did the woman do? Well, she stood up. Luke 13:13, then he put his hands on her and immediately she straightened up. If you want to be well, you have to start acting well. You've got to stand up. You've got to stand up for yourself and you've got to stand up to the devil. Amen. She stood up and then you know what she did? She praised God. Then he put his hands on her and immediately she straightened up and praised God. If you want to be well, stop complaining and start praising. That's really what we've been dealing with on Wednesday nights, how to walk in the abundance and prosperity of God. Because a lot of folks are hung by the tongue, complaining. Complaining about money, complaining about their husband, complaining about their wife, complaining about their children, complaining about their health. Then what did the haters do? They complained. Jesus prayed, the woman praised, and the haters complained. If you think anything has changed, you haven't been paying attention. Jesus is still healing the sick. The people of God are still praising him, and the haters are still complaining. Verse 14, indignant because Jesus had healed on the Sabbath, the synagogue ruler said to the people, there are 6 days for work. Come and be healed on those days, not on the Sabbath. But don't be too hard on the haters, though, because they're a lot like today's generation. They loved animals more than they love people. Verse 15, the Lord answered him, you hypocrites, doesn't each of you on the Sabbath untie his ox or donkey from the stall and lead it out to give it water? Then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her? In other words, they were taking care of their animals, but they had a beef. They had a complaint about this woman being healed on the Sabbath. I'm not anti-animal. Amen. A few weeks ago, I actually slowed down to let a squirrel cross the road. I'm getting mellow in my old age. Amen. I'm not against animals. But they're animals. They're not people. Amen. Whom did Jesus say had kept this woman bound for 18 years, even though she was a daughter of Abraham? Satan. She was a daughter of Abraham. She was a child of the covenant. And you see all the ways preachers can get people messed up on a topic like this. Well, it's the will of God. Well, God's trying to teach you something. Well, if God were a merciful God, would he let someone suffer for 18 years? Well, he will if you're ignorant. I'm about to say a hard thing now, so brace yourselves. When I was praying about money in 1989, I wasn't praying, I was complaining. 1989, I would have been married 13 years, faithfully married. 1989, I would have been a tither 29 years. But we weren't making it. The previous year, the Lord had told us to pioneer St. Paul's Preparatory Academy, even though the church was in the red, because we had moved from the hotel to our first church building, and we had the stock crash in October of 87, which really didn't affect anybody I was pastoring, but it slowed the economy down. It tapped the brakes. And I didn't know then what I know now. I thought I was praying. I wasn't praying. I was complaining. Lord, I'm tired of not ever having any money. And he spoke to me, and he did not say, well, FedEx will be here tomorrow morning by 10 a.m. That's not what he said. He said, son, you don't ever have any money because you never save any money. He corrected me. Imagine the audacity. So you know what I had to do? I had to change. But watch it now. I didn't just have to change spending everything I took in. I didn't just have to change and start saving money personally and in the ministry every 7 days. I had to change my big, fat mouth.
Come on, Pastor.
Now think about what I'm saying. I've been faithfully married 13 years. The Lord couldn't have found anything to judge me over with regard to that. I'd been a tither 24 years. Tither. 24 years. The Lord couldn't have found fault with me there. The church was tithing, still does. 10% of everything that comes in as a tithe or the general fund, we move over to missions. We may not spend it today, but it'll be gone. Amen. Hung by the tongue. See, a lot of the strategy of the devil is to get you mad at God. Because when you're mad at God, you are done. Game over. It is finished. David said, my help cometh from the Lord. I look to the hills from whence cometh my help. You see, if I say, well, God is sending me this trouble, well, where's my help coming from? If I come to the conclusion that God messed me up, well, who am I going to turn to? This is the snake in the garden. Amen. And preachers, because they don't want to admit, well, you know, maybe they didn't pray, maybe they didn't study, maybe they don't know what they're talking about. They don't want to admit any of that, or they don't want to say, well, have you prayed? Because I can't do all your praying for you.
That's right, amen.
What's coming out of your mouth when you're not at church? Do you have bitterness and unforgiveness in your heart? Because it'll stop faith cold. They don't want to deal with all that, so they say, well, God did this to you. God put this on you. God is teaching you something. Yeah, he's teaching you to change churches. If that's what your preacher's saying, amen. You know, nothing's really changed. Religious leaders back then are like religious leaders today. Blame God. Untie the ass and blame God. Amen. That's a King James word for donkey. Amen. Take care of your animals and blame God. I'm not going to do it. I said, I'm not going to do it. I'm going to say that if there's a shortcoming, it's on my part or it's on your part. It's not on God's part. Amen. Amen. If somebody let down, I let down or you let down, but God didn't let down. I mean, where do we go if God be against us? Verse 16, then should not this woman, a daughter of Abraham, whom Satan has kept bound for 18 long years, be set free on the Sabbath day from what bound her? Now, I'm going to answer a question. It'd be a good thing maybe to jot a couple of things down. How does Satan do this? How does Satan do this? Well, let's go to Acts 10:38. Acts 10:38 talks about how God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with him. And I looked up this Greek word, great big long Greek word, under the power of the devil. And actually what it means is they were being oppressed by the devil, and it is a present participle. And that's what really catches my attention. It is a present participle. Everybody say present participle. Now, if you went to school, if you graduated from school after, let's say, 75, you may not know what a present participle is. You may know all about global warming, but you may not know what a present participle is. A present participle means continuous, ongoing action. So think about it. For 18 years, Satan had an ongoing action against that woman. We could call it an assignment. Maybe some demon or some spirit had been assigned against her and stayed right with it. We know that those devils stay right with their habitation because when Jesus cast the legion out of that man, they wanted to go somewhere. So he allowed them to go into a herd of pigs. And they immediately destroyed the herd of pigs. It is the nature of Satan to steal and to kill and to destroy. Not to have a party, not to show you a good time. That's what he does because that's who he is. How God anointed Jesus of Nazareth with the Holy Spirit and power, and how he went around doing good and healing all who were being oppressed by the devil. Why are people sick? Jesus went around healing people who were under the power of the devil. Why are people sick? Jesus went around healing people who were being oppressed by the devil. Ongoing, continuous, present tense action. They were being oppressed by the devil. Now, when you wake up to this, hear me now, when you wake up to this, whatever has been going on in your body, you're going to rise up and say, hell no. Amen. No, 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 no. I mean, think about it. Yeah, but you know, this is my body type. Oppressed by a devil is your body type? Well, this is in my DNA. Oppressed by a devil is in your DNA? Well, everybody in my family has had this. Everybody in your family has been oppressed by a devil? Well, the doctor says, you know, that because of my family history, there is a high likelihood that you will be oppressed by a devil. See, when you wake up, you go to war. See, if you think it's your DNA, well, you cope. If you think it's your body type, you cope. If you think you have a glandular issue, you cope. But once you deal with the reality that it is the ongoing, continuous action, oppression by the devil, something on the inside of a born again, spirit-filled child of the living God rises up and says, hell no! I'm not going to live my life oppressed by a devil. Well, I wonder how come I'm not getting my prayers answered. Because you're too calm. I mean, if you're there in bed in the middle of the night, I don't know how you do. Maybe you do this. Maybe you do this. You know, millennials. You know, the alarm goes off. Do you hide under the sheets? Kick your wife and say, see what that is. While you cower under the covers and say, I sure hope it's nothing. I sure hope it's nothing. I sure hope it goes away. I sure hope there's nothing bad's gonna happen. Is that what you do? Oh, not me. And the alarm go off. I open up the box on the nightstand. I give me a 45 with a laser. I grab an extra clip in my left hand and I start slithering down the hall. And inevitably I hear a little voice say, it was me. Because I go to bed early. you know, because I get up early. But I mean, I go to war. The alarm go off. I'm ready for a fight. See, Satan has law, and these preachers, I don't think they meant any harm. They're just ignorant. Amen. I mean, I don't think they're evil. Maybe they're illiterate, but I don't think they're evil. See, once it occurs to you that it's not your body type, it's not your DNA, it's not your family history, it is Satan. And it's not even something he did way back 10 years back. It is a present tense, ongoing, continuous action of oppression. Oh, man, I can put a stop to that. Hallelujah. Now, I'm going to say something that you need to make a note. I have no Bible for what's about to come out of my mouth, but it is my experience, but that doesn't carry any weight. But this is my experience. My experience is that when I see it for what it is and instantly resist the devil, instantly I get results. But what I'm working on right now in my own personal life is this. When I have let the devil squat, then it takes some time. Now I'm working on that. That's what I'm working on in prayer. And I don't have Bible on this. Maybe I'm wrong. Maybe I'm going to come across the verse tomorrow in Bible study, and I'm going to see I was wrong. And then, because, you know, faith cometh by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Once I see it in the Word of God, that there is no difference in time, well, then I'll operate on that basis. But anybody here that has rent houses know if you have a squatter, you'd like to just go in there with the 357 and get them out. But you can't do that. There are procedures, and it takes what?
Time.
But I could be wrong. That could be my natural thinking. But I know this. On my left wrist a few months back, because I moved instantly, on March 7, 1982, that night Austin was born, because I moved instantly. I know this, that when I move instantly, there's no contest, and the devil doesn't even have a chance. He didn't have a chance to squat because I didn't pull out a chair. So what we need to do from this day, what is today, March 26, 2017, we need, from this day to our last day, we need to see how the devil operates. And when he first pulls out his snake out of his bag of snakes, we instantly identify what's going on, and we say, no, you're not going to do that here. You're not going to do that to me. I'm not going to have that. I'm not going to tolerate that. I'm not going to put up with that. You're a defeated foe, Colossians 2:15. Jesus made an open show and spectacle of you on Calvary's cross. Jesus put to naught your every work. Get out. Amen. See, once you see what is going on, and that's how Jesus operated. He saw. Now, we've already looked at in this series, Mark 8:22. Let's go there. Two quick illustrations. Mark 8:22. They came to Bethsaida, and some people brought a blind man and begged Jesus to touch him. He took the blind man by the hand and led him outside the village. This is fascinating. Why did he lead the man outside the village? Well, because Jesus himself had cursed the village. There are places, geographical places, that are cursed. Haven't you ever wondered about Washington, D.C., for example? How can you send a good man to Washington, D.C., and before you know it, they lose their mind and they're doing everything except what we sent them there to do? Matthew 11:21 and Luke 10:13, Jesus himself cursed Bethsaida. We see also in verse 26, after the man was healed, Jesus said to the man, don't go into the village. So there are places to be avoided. When he had spit on the man's eyes and put his hands on him, Jesus asked, do you see anything? He looked up and said, I see people. They look like trees walking around. So we have improvement, we have progress, but we don't have healing. Verse 25, once more Jesus put his hands on the man's eyes, then his eyes were opened, his sight was restored, and he saw everything clearly, and Jesus sent him home saying, don't go into the village. Now listen to what I'm saying. Jesus Christ himself had to pray for a man more than once. If Jesus Christ himself had to pray for this man more than one time, we should not allow our hearts to be discouraged if the manifestation of our healing takes some time. Now compare that to Luke 18. We've already given you Luke 18, the parable. Luke 18 is a parable. Verse 1 gives us the point of the parable. Then Jesus told his disciples a parable to show them that they should always pray and not give up. Say it out loud. I should always pray and not give up. So Jesus taught that we should always pray and never give up. And in Mark 8, Jesus himself had to pray for a blind man more than once. So we should always pray and never give up. Now, I encourage you to get a copy of The Believer's Authority by Kenneth Hagin. Read the whole thing. And then go back and read chapter 4 over and over and over and over. Because chapter 4 is breaking the power of the devil. Because there are a couple of ways to go about this the wrong way. If I go to God and I'm complaining, well, obviously that's not going to work. If I go to God and I'm asking him according to John 16, I think it's verses 23 and 24, if I ask him for the same thing over and over and over and over and over, two things happen and they're both negative. Number one, I'm offending God. And number two, I'm actually building unbelief into my heart. It'll come to me in a minute who said that or who wrote that. I can go to God and I can demand my covenant rights under the new covenant. That's in John 14. Jesus said, John 14, he wasn't talking about praying. He said, whatever you ask in my name, I will do. And the word ask is not the word ask. It is the word demand in the Greek. Whatever you demand as your covenant rights and privileges in my name, I will do. Now, we're not making a demand of God. We're making a demand of faith. That's what Peter and John did at the gate called Beautiful. Silver and gold have we not, but that which we have we give you. In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, walk. What did they do? They made a demand of faith on that name. See, the bottom line is we've let go of our power. We've let go of our authority. We've let go of the work of Christ, which is already done. And we're just living lives coping. I never told you the rest of the story on when I said, brace yourselves, I'm gonna say a hard thing on money, because I had to change my big fat mouth. And I did, and it offended people. I changed my mouth and it offended people. See, you've got Jesus healing, and you've got the believers praising, and you got the haters complaining, and nothing's changed. Amen. I stopped talking poor. I mean, I was in the red. I mean, I wasn't even making it. I mean, personally and corporately. I mean, I remember one day somebody found some envelopes around the sound booth there at I-30 and Fielder Road and looked inside, and somebody had not put tithes and offerings in the bucket. It was $400 and change. Oh, man, we were so excited in the office. And, you know, we had a list in a spreadsheet, and so we could sort, you know, by different ways. We sorted from the least to the highest. And of course, you know, you ought to pick the big bill for $400 to pay it. Oh, no, we're trying to get 3 pages, single space down. So we paid the least bills, $400 worth. We were so excited. But I changed my mouth. And I stopped talking poor. People got upset. All my needs are met. All my bills are paid. I have more than I need. I can go where I want. I can do what I want. I can eat where I want. I can stay where I want. I can drive what I want. I can live where I want. I can buy what I want. Well, you know, now this is 2017. You know, everybody says, yeah, he blessed. He old. He's blessed. But I'm talking about 1989. And except for money in retirement accounts, I didn't have two nickels to rub together. Oh, you're lying. How can I quote God and be lying? See, now everybody says, oh, yeah. You know, in other words, they just take it for granted. You have no idea. You have no idea. You have no idea. You have no idea. We had a car that was just eating us alive in repairs. I went over to the BMW store, and it's a long story, but anyway, I bought a one-year-old BMW 535, $36,000 sticker, a year old, had 11,000 miles on it, paid $24,000. I had people leave the church over it. And they didn't know the story because, I mean, I didn't have any money, but I had credit. I borrowed 100% on that car. Well, Dr. Lingerfelt, the good news is BMW Financial will let you borrow 100% on this car, but they want the tax, title, and license paid. No problemo. I slid a Visa card across the desk. Except for retirement accounts, I mean, we didn't have two nickels to rub together. But I changed my mouth. I'm telling you, brothers and sisters, my brothers and sisters in the Lord Jesus Christ, if you want to change your life, change your mouth. Stop giving glory to the devil. Pastor, I never give glory to the devil. Every time a complaint comes out of your mouth, you are glorifying the devil and you're giving him credit and glory and honor for your life being jacked up. I just made up my mind. I wasn't gonna do that anymore. I was gonna stop glorifying the devil, and I was gonna start glorifying God. And I'm telling you, there's something that's scratching in the back of your mind when you start down this road. You're lying. And I just learned to say, well, how can I be lying if I'm quoting God? All my needs are met. Philippians 4:19. My God is meeting all of my needs. Philippians 4:19. I'm being made rich in every way so that I can be generous on every occasion. How can I be lying if I'm quoting God? Amen. And by and by, say by and by.
By and by.
Say by and by.
By and by.
The money came. The manifestation followed the confession. Now, of course, people go nuts and they start confessing they have 100 oil wells. Kenneth Hagin used to say, if God wouldn't do that for him, he's not going to do that for you. Amen. And you can do the exact same thing here on this passage we're in right here, Luke 13. Thank you, Father God. Jesus took up my infirmities and bore my diseases. Thank you, Father God. See, the devil's a liar. Every time you feel something in your body, the devil's a liar. Jesus took up my infirmities and bore my diseases. Hallelujah. Take Colossians 2:15. You can do it. I didn't bring other verses. All authority has been given unto me. Then he turned right around and said, I give you authority to trample on snakes and scorpions and overcome all the power of the enemy. Nothing shall by any means harm you. Nothing shall by any means harm you. Did he define nothing? Is nothing just like snakes or evil spirits or... No, he didn't define nothing. So nothing could be sickness. Nothing could be disease. Nothing could be whatever's going around town. Nothing shall by any means harm you. So I've been given authority. Well, I just choose to use my authority. And I go to Colossians 2:15. Jesus made an open show and spectacle of Satan on Calvary's cross. One translation says, Jesus put to naught every work of the devil. So I every time I feel something in my body, I just lift my hands. Don't let a complaint come out of your mouth. Lift my hands and give glory to God. Thank you, Father God. The power of Satan is broken over my body in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth and by the blood of the Lamb. And I thank you, Father God, that Jesus took up my infirmities and bore my diseases, and with his stripes I have been healed. I give you credit, glory, and honor, Father God, because you are my truth-telling Father, and the devil is defeated and his power over my body is broken. Yes. And by and by, everybody say, by and by.
By and by.
And by and by. Well, Pastor, how come all this stuff's going on? Because we allowed it. The Bible says, neither give place to the devil. Why would the Bible say, neither give place to the devil, if you could not give place to the devil? The Bible says, resist the devil. Why would the Bible say, resist the devil, if resistance was futile? Change your life by changing your confession. Get the complaint out and get the praise in. Psalm 37:4. I was spent an hour this morning in Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord and he will give you the desires of your heart. Hallelujah. So whatever Satan's been tormenting you over, get up tomorrow morning and just start dancing before the Lord and quoting Psalm 37:4. Delight yourself in the Lord and he'll give you the desires of your heart. Hallelujah, I delight myself in you, Father God, and I praise your holy name because, and whatever it is you got going, I delight myself in you, Father God, and I praise your holy name because the power of Satan is broken over my body. In fact, why don't we say that out loud together? I delight myself in you, my Father God, and I praise your holy name because the power of Satan is broken over my body. And I'm the healed of Almighty God, from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Let's do it again. I delight myself in you, my Father God, and I praise your holy name because the power of Satan is broken over my body. And I'm the healed of Almighty God, from the crown of my head to the soles of my feet. Hallelujah. Well, let's bow our heads. I want to give an opportunity for people to make their commitments and decisions for the Lord this morning. I don't want to see anybody go to hell. I don't want to see anybody here go to hell. Hell is a horrible place. Hell was never even created for man. Hell was created for the devil and the one-third of the angels who rebelled with him against God. But the fact of the matter is that God so loved the world, he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever would believe on him would not perish but have everlasting life. And I want you to think about John 3:16 in a new light, and here it is. That God so loved the world, and the world there is cosmos, it's the world people. God so loved people that he gave his only begotten Son. He gave his Son. And if you reject Jesus, you reject what God did for you. If you reject Jesus, you reject God's love. Everybody legally has been provided for, but you have to take action on it. You've got to make it yours. John 3 says he stands at the door and knocks. If anyone hears his voice, he will come in and fellowship with them and them with he. But we have to open the door. We've got to let him in. We've got to invite him in. We've got to take Jesus as ours. How many this morning would say, Pastor Gene, I've never given my life to God through the Lord Jesus Christ. I've never made Jesus Christ my Lord and Savior personally and individually, but I want to do so this morning. If that's you this morning, wherever you are, lift a hand up, lift it up high enough to where I can see it. If that's you, Pastor, I'm saying yes to Jesus and to His sacrifice on my behalf. I want to pray the prayer. I want to give my life to God through the Lord Jesus Christ. If that's you this morning, lift a hand up. We're going to pray. There may be others here this morning. You're backslidden. You're not living for the Lord like you once were. You told God that you loved Him, that you'd live for Him, and you meant it when you prayed it. But over the passing of time, you've allowed your heart to grow dim toward the things of God, and you're not living for the Lord like you once were. You're not on fire for the Lord. You're not excited for the things of God like you once were. The Word says in 1 John 1:9, if we confess our sins, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. How many this morning would say, Pastor, that's me, pray for me. I'm away from God and I don't want to remain backslidden. I want to recommit my life to God through the Lord Jesus Christ and I want to make it right. I want to renew my fellowship with Father God. If that's you this morning, wherever you are, lift a hand up, lift it up high enough to where I can see it. Yes. How many others? Yes. How many others? There's more. This is it. Today's your day. For the sake of these that have raised their hands and others, yes, thank you. Let's pray this prayer out loud together. Father God, I give you my life. Time's gone by. I've gone my own way. I've done my own thing. I've lived for self. But I call an end to those days. I'm going to live for you. I invite you to come into my life. Take charge of my life. Be the Lord of my life. I thank you, Father God, for your gift of the Lord Jesus Christ. I receive Him. I claim Him. I take Him as my Savior. And I thank you, Father God, for not rejecting me, but for receiving me unto yourself and into your family. It's in Jesus' name I pray. And everyone in agreement said amen. Amen. If you are one of those who raised your hand for either invitation to pray that prayer, after the service, I want you to see the good folks out at guest services and ask for a copy of my book, God's Very Own Child. They'll give you a copy of that. Anybody here this morning, if you don't have a Bible and you want a Bible, you can see them. They'll give you a Bible. We want to be a blessing to you. Amen. Hallelujah. I know one thing, the days are short. And we need to take a message like today's message and we need to build it into our spirit man so that we can be the body of Christ on the earth now. We are the body of Christ. How much does your body do without its head? How many places does your body go without its head? Who gives direction to your body? What part gives direction to your body? The head. He is the head. And we are the body. And the reason we don't see Christ doing a whole lot on the earth is because we're not doing a whole lot on the earth. We are the body of Christ. We are the only Jesus that is here right now. Once we see it, we'll live different lives. Amen. And start proclaiming. You're set free. You're healed. You're delivered. Jesus has saved you. Accept it. Believe it. Receive it. And it'll be yours. Hallelujah. And their lives will change. Because Satan is able to hold people under oppression because of ignorance. And when we preach the good news, the light shines, it dawns on them. They hear, they believe, they receive, they begin to confess. And Satan then has got to go. Can you say amen? Amen.